السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We commence as always by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sending complete blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless him and his entire household, to bless all his companions and to bless every single one of us and to grant us goodness, mashallah. Seeing the smiles on the faces, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. We ask him to grant us acceptance, the fasts that we have kept, as well as the Quran that we have read and listened to in the month of Ramadan. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us and make us from those whom he grants complete forgiveness in a way that we return as pure as the day we were born. Ameen. Beloved brothers and sisters, as we had said, the battle of Tabuq, there were several categories of people that had stayed behind. The first, those who had excuses. The second, those who did not have any excuses. From amongst them were those who were forgiven. And from amongst them were the hypocrites of Medina, and from amongst them were the hypocrites from outside Medina. And as for the hypocrites, they were not really worried about what people thought about them, because they came with their excuses to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam even before they had gone out to Tabuk, before the army had gone out to Tabuk. But there were three people who were very worried because they had had no excuse. They were not hypocrites and they knew they did not come to present their excuses to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam before they left. The names of these three: the first one, Hilal ibn Umayyah radiyallahu anhu. The second one, Ka'b ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu. And the third one, Murarah ibn Rabi' radiyallahu anhu. May Allah be pleased with all three of them. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam met Ka'b ibn Malik when they came back from Tabuk and asked him, "Where were you? Why didn't you come with us?" So Ka'b ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, he was a truthful man. He did not have any excuse. He says, "O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, if I were to lie to you to make you happy, you may become happy, but I will be exposed by revelation. And if I were to tell you the truth, perhaps you will be upset with me," meaning I don't have an excuse. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told him, after he had explained that he had no excuse, that go away from us until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clears your names. Allah will decide what exactly was your condition. And the same happened to Hilal ibn Umayyah, and the same happened to Murara ibn Rabi'. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them. So these three, everyone stopped talking to them. Upon the instruction of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were waiting clarification of the names of these three from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Clarification did not come, not anytime soon. A time came when even the greeting was left. They would actually come in front of the messenger and greet him, "Assalamu alaykum," and he would turn away as per the instruction of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why did you stay back when it was compulsory, fardu ayn, compulsory upon you to have come out? You left an obligation between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and now you want to come and present excuses? And now you want to come and be from amongst those who is saying that, "Look, I really am sorry"? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will clarify your name. The reason here is because there were hypocrites that were admonished and exposed in the Quran. So Allah says, those whom you go back to, who had remained behind, when you get to them, they will present excuses. Do not accept their excuses. Listen to the verses. يَعْتَذِرُونَ إِلَيْكُمْ إِذَا رَجَعْتُمْ إِلَيْهِمْ قُلْ لَا تَعْتَذِرُوا لَنْ نُؤْمِنَ لَكُمْ قَدْ نَبَّأَنَا اللَّهُ مِنْ أَخْبَارِكُمْ. They will present excuses when you get back to them as to why they did not come to the expedition of Tabuk. Tell them, "We are not going to accept your excuses. Allah has exposed you and Allah has informed us about you." So this is why Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accepted nobody's excuses. If there was to be an exception, it was only by revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there came a time when these three found it so difficult to exist in Medina Munawwara. They used to come for Salah, no one greets them. No one responds their greeting, no one looks at them. And these are companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A day goes by, a week goes by, 10 days go by, 20 days, a month goes by. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructs their wives to separate from them. Subhanallah. In the meantime, these people have no hatred in their heart. They are making dua to Allah. Ya Allah, forgive us. Ya Allah, cleanse our name. Ya Allah, clear us. Ya Allah, we ask you forgiveness. Ya Allah, we have wronged. We want you to forgive us. And they continued without losing hope. The wife of Hilal ibn Umayyah. Hilal ibn Umayyah radiallahu anhu was an elderly man. The wife of Hilal ibn Umayyah came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Rasulallah, my husband is a very old man. Do you allow me to take care of him at least? To take care of him? There is nothing more that I will do besides serve him because he is old. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made the exception for Hilal ibn Umayyah radiallahu anhu. And as for the other two, no exception. There came a time when they were so narrowed, as broad as the earth was, they felt there is nowhere to go. Where can we go? And one day the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes out of his room and he was so happy, so happy. Why was he so happy? Because Jibreel alayhi salatu was salam came to him with verses. وَعَلَى الثَّلَاثَةِ الَّذِينَ خُلِّفُوا حَتَّى إِذَا ضَاقَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَرْضُ بِمَا رَحُبَتْ وَضَاقَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ أَنفُسُهُمْ وَظَنُّوا أَلَّا مَلْجَأَ مِنَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا إِلَيْهِ ثُمَّ تَابَ عَلَيْهِمْ لِيَتُوبُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. Verses clarifying that these three in particular who had stayed behind from the battle of Tabuq have been forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after what had happened when the earth became so narrow for them, although it was so broad, and after their hearts became so hurt and they had engaged in tawbah and so on. Allah says Allah has accepted their tawbah and they are forgiven. So when the companions came, they all began to congratulate these people and embrace them and say, Allah has indeed declared that you people were truthful in that. You had no excuse. Your tawbah was truthful. You are not from amongst the hypocrites. And Allah has forgiven you. Malik, Ka'b ibn Malik radiallahu anhu says, no, I want the messenger to come. And when the messenger came sallallahu alayhi wasallam and informed him the news, he says, is it from you or is there revelation? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam read the verses. He was so happy, delighted. Now there are verses in the Quran that we read up to the day of Qiyamah, clarifying the names of certain people from amongst them, these three. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. This was after 50 days of suffering by these three. This was the payment they had to pay. They engaged in tawbah for 50 days. They had to endure the ignoring of all the people, including those who were most beloved to them at the top of the list, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not speaking to them at all because of their sins, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cleansed them and clarified their name. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us also purity, and may He make us not from amongst the hypocrites. May He clear us and clarify us. Sometimes you have people who label others. Sometimes they spread rumor about others. They spread rumor about us. Who will clarify our names besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So in the same way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cleansed the names of those in the past, although that was through revelation, but it is also Allah through His miracle that can cleanse our names. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from false accusation, and more importantly, may Allah protect us from messing our tongues, falsely accusing others. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really grant us pure tongues. Ameen. Then when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got back from this battle of Tabuk, this thing had happened, and in a few days, a group of people came to meet the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who were they? The people of Thaqif, the people of Ta'if, those who had harmed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than once. Those whom he had made a dua for before Hijrah. Those whom he had made a dua for after Hijrah. After the battle of Hunayn as well, he was asked, O messenger, raise your hands and pray against these people. He says, O Allah, guide these people and let them come to me in the condition of Islam. So the same man, Abdi Ali ibn Amr, he comes with a group of six people all together. And he decided, let's go to Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara. As they were coming, Al-Mughira ibn Shu'ba radiallahu anhu sees them. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu also sees them. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu told Al-Mughira ibn Shu'ba, let me run and inform Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the people of Ta'if are coming, subhanallah. So he went and he told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was very happy. When they came, he welcomed them. They were his guests, subhanallah. He put up a little tent in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or according to some narrations, right outside the masjid, in a way that they could hear what happened in the masjid. The Quran, they could hear it. They could see what was happening amongst the believers. They were surprised and amazed. For the first time, they actually lent an ear to what was happening. Up to this time, they did not want to hear. Remember in Taif what happened? They did not want to hear anything. They just began to beat this man, na'udhu billah. And the battle of Hunayn, they didn't hear a thing. So they did not really know what Islam was all about. Now they sat and they heard. And after they heard, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after he had obviously one of the most hospitable people in existence, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with his hospitality, they had stayed. And he then speaks to them, enter the fold of Islam. It's about time you came into the fold. So this Abdi Ali ibn Amr, he says, we have a few questions for you. What are the questions? Number one, we have heard you say that adultery is prohibited. What is it with adultery? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, it is totally prohibited, and he read the verse, وَلَا تَقْرَبُ الزِّنَا. Don't even go close to adultery. So this Abdi Ali says, you know, our people, they are involved in it in a big way. If we're going to tell them not to do it, you know, they won't bear patience. They are definitely going to continue engaging in it, and it's very impossible for them to abstain from this that is ingrained in their blood since they were born. He's actually telling the messenger that we can't adopt this rule. Then he says, the other one we want to ask you about is riba and interest. What about riba and interest? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam recited the verse which explained that that is prohibited. He says, how can we bear patience against that? We have so much dealings full of interest, and now you are telling us to cut it completely, totally, instantaneously. It's not going to happen. It's very difficult. And the third question they asked, what about alcohol? This khamr, the wines and the alcohol that we drink, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam read the verse again. He said, this is very difficult. Our people are engrossed in it, buying, selling, drinking, getting drunk. They enjoy it. And this is what they do in their spare time. When they have their wealth, they spend it in this and so on. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this is the deen. Not from me. I don't make it on my own. It is revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one of them uttered. They started speaking to one another. They said, you see all these people here, they all used to commit adultery, or a lot of them, and a lot of them were involved in interest, and a lot of them used to drink, but they all left it. So I'm sure we could leave it. Look at the common sense. If they can leave it, why can we not leave it? Look at the sense of these people from Ta'if. How many of us are ready to learn from them that we can leave it if the others have left it? You see, others are pure. Why do you have to go to the nightclub? Why do you have to go to drink alcohol? What about the rest of them? Why can't you abstain just like everybody else has abstained? May Allah protect us. Remember, Allah gives us chance after chance. We have bad habits. It is lessons like these from the seerah that soften our hearts. And this is when we should be turning to Allah. If the dunya has left interest, why can't we? If they have left adultery, why can't we? If they have left alcohol, why can't we? If they have not gambled, why do we continue gambling? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us, and may He grant us a turning point. So they decided, okay, we are declaring that you are the messenger of Allah. We have accepted Islam, subhanallah. And we have considered what you have said as prohibited, and we will not engage in it. Look at this. Moments ago they were asking questions and they were promising it's not going to be possible. And a few moments later they said, if everyone else has done it, we should be doing it as well. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us steadfastness. May He make us from those who look at those who are higher than us in spirituality so that we can move up the ladder. And may He make us from those who look at those who are lower than us in material wealth so that we can appreciate what we have. This is the teaching of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, "Unzuru ila man huwa dunakum." When it comes to your problems and your difficulties and your material issues, look at those who are in a worse condition. It will make you appreciate the beauty that you are in. Don't ever look at those in a higher material position, because then you won't appreciate what you have. You don't have one leg, look at those who don't have both legs. But don't look at those who are running on their feet. Perhaps Allah has tested them with something else. But when it comes to religion, look at those who are higher than you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will assist you to actually go up the ladder when you appreciate those who have achieved, mashallah. You see someone in salah all night, you tell yourself, at least I should read a portion of it. It will protect you from having missed a salah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So these people then went back to their people. But they asked the messenger one more thing. They said, you see, we have a massive idol. Allat was based in their region. He says, Abdi Alil ibn Amr says, for 3 years we don't want you to destroy that idol. Leave it, because we have women who worship it, we have children. If we destroy it all at once, perhaps they will feel something in their hearts. The Prophet said, no. They said, okay, 1 year. He said, no. He said, okay, 1 month. He said, no. It should be destroyed immediately. So they said, okay, can you excuse us from destroying it? You send someone. So he said, no problem, I will send. He sent Al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah radiallahu anhu. And I want to make mention of a beautiful story that is mentioned in some of the books of history. When I read it, I laughed. So I thought to myself, let me also share it with you. It's mentioned in the books of history that Al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah radiallahu anhu, he was a companion who was very jocular. He used to like to joke. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent him with a few people to destroy Al-Lat. And the people of Thaqif, they all gathered. There's about 10-15 men with Al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah come from Medina Munawwara, and they have to destroy Al-Lat. He takes the axe, and everyone is telling, you know, they have this belief in them. They've been worshipping it since before they were born, meaning their forefathers. And to them, this was their God now going. So they said, this man is going to die as soon as he strikes this idol. He's going to die. Look, he cannot hit it. Even though they were people who knew what was going on, and they knew what the teachings of Islam were, but they were still under this false notion that this thing here is going to harm the man. So it's reported in one of the narrations that Al-Mughira ibn Shu'bah, he looked at them and Allahu Akbar, he struck the idol and he fell down. And when he fell down, they said, you see, we told you. And immediately after he heard them say all their things, he got up and started laughing. And he tells them, what do you think? You think this thing is going to harm me? He says, subhanallah, Allah is the Khaliq. This is a stone that will never harm or benefit, let alone others, but even itself. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And then he destroyed this entire idol with the help of the others. And this was the end of the shirk in that particular region. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then caused Islam to spread very, very fast, because these people were strong. In no time, their people also accepted Islam. What was happening? The groups were coming to Medina Munawwara. Delegations were coming to Medina Munawwara. So much so that the 9th year of Hijrah was known as the year of delegations. In total, there were more than 70 delegations that came to Medina Munawwara. And more than 20 in this particular year. In fact, some of the scholars take it to up to 50 delegations in 1 year, until it was known as the year of delegations. What was happening? Delegations were coming one after the other, and they were asking questions, accepting Islam. Some of them had accepted Islam and were just coming to declare their pledge. And some of them, they came to learn and they spent some time. Some were in large numbers, some delegations made up of only one man. They came, they learned, they went back to their people, they told them what happened, and the people were accepting Islam. Am bakrati abihim, all of them, afwajan, in armies and in droves, they were accepting Islam. Subhanallah. Now, we had made mention yesterday, I'm not going to repeat it, but I just want to highlight the point of the death of the head of the hypocrites in the 9th year of Hijrah. And this was after that Masjid Dirar was destroyed. The hypocrite, the leader, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, had died, and we made mention of it in a little bit of detail yesterday. In the same year, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lost one of his family members again. The previous year, he lost Zainab binti Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That was in the 8th year of Hijrah. How did she pass away? Do you know, the books of history make mention of the fact that when she was making the hijrah, because Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi' after the battle of Badr was sent back, if you recall the story, and he was told to send his wife, who was the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, allow her to make hijrah. As she was leaving, Quraysh began to harm her to the degree that they dropped her from the top of her animal, and she suffered a miscarriage according to some narrations, and she was very ill thereafter. She remained ill until the day she passed away a few years later. This was Zainab binti Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She was a woman whose husband, being a mushrik, still praised her. And he said, if I were to choose from all the women of Quraysh, I still would choose my own wife who I have, the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that was in the 8th year. In the 9th year, he lost another daughter of his, Kulthum, who was married to Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu after the death of Ruqayya binti Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you recall, after the battle of Badr, Ruqayya radiallahu anha passed away. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got another daughter of his married to Uthman. And upon the death of Kulthum, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, oh Uthman, if I had had another daughter, I would have got her married to you. Subhanallah. This is from the virtue of Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu. What a powerful son-in-law. What a great man. What a great friend. And what a great family member. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us qualities of this nature. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. There was another death that took place in this 9th year. Some narrations say the 8th year of Hijrah, and some of the narrations say the 9th year of Hijrah. This was one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam got up and he told his companions, let's get up and read Salatul Janazah upon a brother of yours who has passed away in Abyssinia. Subhanallah. This was An-Najashi. And while he was in Medina Munawwara, the Prophet ﷺ was informed that An-Najashi has passed away. So therefore, he instructed his companions to get up, and he led Salatul Janazah upon a man who was in Abyssinia, because there was no one there to lead Salatul Janazah on him. And here the Prophet ﷺ led As-Salah al-Ghaib, Salah of Janazah, upon a person who was absent at the time. And the Prophet ﷺ told his people that this An-Najashi was from amongst those who had died on that particular day. Then also in the 9th year of Hijrah, the Prophet ﷺ sent Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu for Hajj with the Muslims. As the leader of Hajj, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu went. One might ask, why did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam not go in the 9th year? He makes mention of some reasons that in Makkah, two things were happening, two main things were happening that were very negative and very bad. One was, they had a habit of promising things, and then if the thing happens, they would then make tawaf around the Kaaba naked, men and women. And sometimes if they wanted something to happen, they would first come around the Kaaba, make tawaf naked, and then they would pray that that thing had happened. They would pray to their idols and so on. So although Makkah was victorious and it was under Muslim hands, there were still people who were not Muslims in Makkah al-Mukarramah. And they still used to engage in this type of activity. So the Prophet ﷺ said, I don't want to go there whilst the condition is this. Number two, the Hajj. The rituals of Hajj were slightly different from the rituals we have. They did not used to stop in Arafah. They used to be in Muzdalifah, and they treated that as a place of dealing, and they used to buy and sell, and they made it a festival more than anything else. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu with his companions. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu went teaching the people the Islamic teachings of Hajj, exactly how it is supposed to be done. And at the same time, there was an announcement made. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu to meet Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu in order to announce everywhere a few announcements. So why was Ali radiallahu anhu sent? Because when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu left and he was in Dhul Hulayfa, verses were revealed in Medina Munawwara. Bara'atum min Allah wa rasulihi ila alladhina 'ahadtum min al-mushrikeen. Allah has declared freedom from what you have struck as agreement with the mushrikeen. 4 months grace, after that everything shall be null and void between us and them. null and void, which means go and announce to them a few things. One is, no one will make tawaf naked after this time, after this year. No mushrik will make hajj after this year. It's only for the Muslims. Subhanallah. So this was some of the announcements. And the announcement that if there is anything that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has promised you, pledged you here, besides certain agreements that were upheld, the rest of them are null and void. It's an Islamic teaching that when you want to declare a treaty, or for example a bilateral agreement, when you want to make it null and void, you must make an announcement, give them some time, a bit of notice. They were given 4 months notice, and they were told after that there's nothing between us and you in terms of agreement, because now Makkah was no longer in the hands of the mushriks. It was now in the hands of the Muslimin. So it came under new leadership, and there were new rules and regulations. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu went for Hajj, mashallah, with a great number of Sahaba radiallahu anhum. They had taken their animals, they had gone out. He had given lectures on the day of Mina, as well as the day of Arafah, as well as the day of the slaughter and sacrifice known as the day of Eid, or Yawmun Nahar, the day of the sacrifice, as well as the day after that of pelting. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu gave lectures, teaching people, telling them what to do, what not to do. And immediately after that, Ali radiallahu anhu would get up and make announcements of the verses that were revealed, and the fact that from next year, nobody's allowed to make tawaf around this Kaaba naked, and no mushrik is allowed to make hajj. And with this announcement and with these verses, the entire period of worship of idols in Makkah came to an end. It came to an end. In fact, in a lot of the region, it was already becoming destroyed. People began to understand the reality of idols, that these idols mean nothing. But this Hajj was very important. And then Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu came back to Al-Madinah al-Munawwara with the companions, and mashallah, they had achieved this Hajj. And this was the Hajj where Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam deputed Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu in order to take the Muslimin and to go for Hajj. In the ninth year of Hijrah, as we made mention, many groups came, many delegations came. I'd like to mention the names of some of these delegations, and perhaps an incident or two of some of the delegations as well. There was a delegation known as Wafdu Abdi Qais. This was the delegation of Abd Qais. They had come through to Madinah Munawwara. There was another delegation of Dhimam ibn Tha'labah, single man delegation. He came to Madinah Munawwara from Banu Sa'ad, and he asks the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is it Allah who instructed you that you should worship none other than him? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, yes. Is it Allah who appointed you as a messenger? Yes. Is it Allah who instructed you that you should tell us that we should read 5 salah? Yes. Is it Allah who instructed you that we should give zakah? Yes. And several other questions. Then he says, I believe that Allah is one, and I believe that you are the messenger. Whatever you have told me to do, I will do, and I'm not going to increase or decrease. That's it. And he went away, this man. One man delegation. He went back to his people, who later accepted Islam. Subhanallah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as this Bedouin left, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells his companions, if this man is truthful, Allah will grant him Jannah in return. If this man is truthful, what was the truthfulness about? Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam had only told him the farad, that which was compulsory. And he said, I'm going to do that, no more and no less. And he went away. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, if this man is truthful, Allah will grant him Jannah in return. And this is why we are taught, what is farad, don't ever compromise that which is compulsory. Don't. And as for that which is extra, the sunnah, the nafil, the more we read, the more complete our farad will be. For example, if your farad, say in salah, sometimes we lack a little bit of concentration, and in fact a lot of the times we lack concentration, perhaps there will be something short in our salah on the day of reckoning. If there is anything short, the hadith says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask the angels, look into any sunnah or voluntary prayer. If there is any, then you can fill what is short in terms of the farad from the sunnah and the nafil. So we'd better have a large stockpile of sunnah and nafil by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the beauty of reading sunnah and nafil, that we will have a stockpile. I'm just calling it that for today. But we will have a large amount of that which will act as a compensation if we are short in what we needed to have had on that particular day. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant it to us. Then there was a very famous delegation known as Wafdu Nasara Najran. The Christians of Najran, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they started talking to him. And every time he had put a tent in one part of the masjid and they would stay there. If there were more, they would actually filter out of the masjid. And they used to sit clean and listen to what was going on from the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you go today, you will find one of the pillars in the Rawda. It says there, Ustawanatul Wufud. This is the pillar where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to meet the delegations. You will notice it is in the masjid, subhanallah. So they came, they sat, they listened, and then they said to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and these people were Christians. They said, we surrendered before you. We are Muslims before you. We accepted Jesus. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, straight to the point, he says, I know more about Jesus than you know. What do you mean you know more? And there was a discussion that happened. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, look, let me be blunt with you. Meaning, he spoke to them directly. And he says, there are three things that are stopping you from entering Islam. That's it. What are the three things? He said, firstly, you worship the cross. Jesus did not teach you to worship the cross. Number one. Number two, he says, you like to consume swine. And Jesus prohibited swine. Subhanallah. Number three, he says, you call Jesus a son of God, and Jesus himself said, I am the messenger of God, not a son of his. Straight to the point. Straight to the point. These are the teachings of Islam. And then they said, no, you are lying, you don't know, and so on. And it became a little bit hot. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called them for what is known as a mubahala. Allah revealed verses, and Allah says, Subhanallah.
إن مثل عيسى عند الله كمثل آدم.
Indeed, the example of Jesus, may peace be upon him, in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is similar to that of Adam. How Allah created him? Allah created this one.
خلقه من تراب.
Allah created him from dust, from soil.
ثم قال له كن.
Then Allah said, be.
فيكون.
And he was. So it was the word of Allah that created Jesus. It was not a begotten son according to Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Then Allah revealed verses immediately after that.
فَمَنْ حَاجَّكَ فِيهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ فَقُلْ تَعَالَوْ.
If someone wants to argue with you about that, after knowledge has come to you regarding that, tell them, come here.
نَدْعُ أَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ وَنِسَاءَنَا وَنِسَاءَكُمْ وَأَنفُسَنَا وَأَنفُسَكُمْ.
We will call our children, your children. Our women, your women. Ourselves, yourselves. Let's stand, you stand this side, we stand this side.
ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ فَنَجْعَلْ لَعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ.
Then we will call for the curse of the Almighty to be upon those who are liars. There we are. So when they heard this, they were shocked. They began to tremble. The messenger began to prepare his family members. Come, let's go. We want to stand and tell these people, the curse of Allah be upon those who are lying regarding Jesus. Let the curse of Allah be upon. They refused. These Nasara of Najran, they refused immediately. And they told each other, do you know this man? He's a Nabi. And do you know what? If he says anything, we are going to be doomed. So the best thing is, let us not make this particular mubahala. Let's not curse ourselves, because we'll go back and be destroyed according to our own prayer and our own dua. And this is when they said, O Messenger, can we not be under your protectorate? I spoke to you yesterday about jizya and how it works, that it is an amount that is paid for people to be under the Muslim protection. Because they are not Muslim, they had to pay an amount. If they were Muslim, it was done for free from the amount that belonged to the entire Muslims. So they said, no, we will pay this amount and send with us someone who is very honest. The Prophet ﷺ said, I will send to you the honest man of our ummah. Get up, O Abu Ubaidah, Amir ibn al-Jarrah, and go with them. And from this narration, we understand that Abu Ubaidah was given a title, Aminu hadhihi al-Ummah. He was known as the trustworthy of this particular ummah. He went with them, and thereafter, it is reported that later on, after some time, they had also accepted Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness, and may He open our doors. Another group of people that had come, there was a man known as Tamim al-Dari. And what happened is, he was a person who had been a Christian before, and he lived in Al-Quds in Palestine for some time. There is quite a long story. He came with a group of people. He declared his Islam when he came to Medina Munawwara, and he was the first man who introduced a lantern in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Before that, it was dark. It was always dark, and they did not have a lamp or a lantern in the masjid. But he was the first one, because of what they used to do in Al-Quds and because of what they used to do in Jerusalem. He then introduced this lantern in the masjid, and this is why Tamim al-Dari radiallahu anhu, he was known as the first person to introduce a lantern in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Some people say that he had come slightly earlier, and some people say that he had come slightly later. There are some narrations. What we have mentioned is the fact that he came, and he came with his group of people. Some of the other groups that came, a group known as the people of Kanda. And these people of Kanda, subhanallah, they came and they asked questions to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them, won't you accept Islam? They said, Bala, indeed we will accept Islam. You have answered our questions, we are satisfied. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them, what is the piece of silk that you have on your necks? They immediately took it out, ripped it, and threw it away. Done. Why am I saying this? To show you that people who accepted Islam, new Muslims, as soon as they were told what was halal and haram, they surrendered to it without even asking a question. He only asked, what is that? Now in Islam, we heard in Medina Munawwara, the Prophet ﷺ got up one day, he put gold in one hand and he put silk in the other, and he says, Inna hadaini haramun ala dhukuri ummati. These two are prohibited for the males of my ummah. There we are. Jewelry, any form of jewelry, prohibited for a male. Males are not allowed to wear jewelry. Jewelry is for females. These people, this soft touch, immediately they ripped it and put it aside. How many of us are ready to give up our chains and earrings that we've been wearing for years as men, as males? We're not talking to the females here. As males, wallahi, if we can give it up for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tonight, perhaps we will enter Jannah just through the one deed that we have on our records. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen our men, our young boys as well. Don't feel hurt that you're going to lose a chain that's stuck around your neck. You remove it immediately, take off your earring, throw it out and say, Ya Allah, if jewelry is not for men, I have heard what the people of Kanda have done, Ya Allah, help me to grant me Jannah in the same way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us Jannah. So this was a lesson that we learn from these people. Then also, there are so many other groups that had come. I won't mention all their names, but one I need to make mention of. The people of Ghassan, those people who had murdered the ambassador of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they actually came in a group of people to Medina Munawwara. These Ghassanites, they had come to declare their Islam. When they declared their Islam, the area of Ghassan became a stronghold of the Muslims in that particular region. Look at the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What happened? In few years, in no time, the whole world around was changing. They were all converting. Where did they convert? By the sword. They converted by knowing what was right, by being convinced after seeing the Muslims, living with them. The Prophet ﷺ gave them opportunity to to listen to the Quran, to ask questions, the questions were responded, and so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. A point that always comes to my mind, I like to look at ourselves, put ourselves in that particular position. We have the Quran, we have Islam, we have all the goodness, we know what is right. Still sometimes we are weak, we find it very difficult to adopt what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clearly dictated. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors, and may He grant us strength. May He make us from those who can use this month of Ramadan as a springboard to paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Really, we should be weeping, we should be crying. We are in the last day or two of the month of Ramadan. And at the same time, we need to make a promise now that this Ramadan is not going to be a Ramadan where we come out of it and go back to our bad habits. That's what we've been doing all along. It's like we worship Allah only in Ramadan. You plug it in, as soon as the heat is over, the air condition is out. You plug it up. Don't treat Ramadan like an appliance that you plug in and plug out when you need and when you don't. No. Ramadan, we plug in inshallah with the idea of benefiting completely thereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. In the ninth year of Hijrah also, there was something else that happened. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had had a son from Mariyah al-Qibtiyah radiyallahu anha, known as Ibrahim ibn al-Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had been sent for suckling and for breastfeeding and to be looked after to a certain area. And there the man of the house was a blacksmith where he used to blow into the ore and so on, causing a lot of smoke and what have you. And this may have resulted in a respiratory disease in this little child, who then passed away in his childhood, in his infancy in fact. And the Prophet ﷺ was called to that place. He picked up his son. When his son was breathing his last few breaths, he did not blame anyone to say, you know what, it's your smoke that killed him. Today we have a problem, really. Sometimes we lose a family member and we start blaming people. Yes, it's different if it was murder, subhanallah. But sometimes we say, no, had you not done this, this wouldn't have happened. And you know, it's because of you that this. Learn from the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not once did he even hint towards the issue that, you know what, this respiratory disease could have been caused because of the blowing of the iron ore by this particular man in whose house this young child of mine was. Not once did he say that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to surrender to his decree. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam held his child and he saw nafsuhu tuqa'qi'u ka'annaha fi shannin fafadat 'aynahu, the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari makes mention of how his eyes became full of tears when he saw his son breathing his last. So the Sahaba asked him, O Messenger, you are crying? He says, innama hiya rahmatun ja'alaha Allahu fi ibadihi ar-rahama. Indeed, this is the mercy that Allah has placed in the hearts of those who have mercy. So to shed a tear is not bad. We are not questioning the decree of Allah. Whatever Allah has done, we are happy with it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson from this. Look, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lost all his children besides Fatima radiyallahu anha. All of them had passed away. His sons, his daughters. We made mention of all of them one after the other. And this was the son in the ninth year of Hijrah passing away. And he is very happy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He cried, he was saddened, not because he was upset with the decree of Allah, but because he had lost his son. So it's okay to cry, to weep. But at the same time, let's learn a lesson. On that day, there was an eclipse. So the people began to say, this eclipse is because the son of Muhammad has passed away. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got up and he made an announcement in the people. Inna ash-shamsa wal-qamara ayatan min ayati Allahi. لا يخسفان لموت أحد ولا لحياته فإذا رأيتم ذلك فاذكروا الله. In one narration, صلوا حتى ينجلي. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, the sun and the moon are signs from the signs of Allah. They do not eclipse because of the life or the death of anybody. They don't. Look, he clarified it. He cleared it. When you see this eclipse, you need to make dua until it returns to normal. And one narration says, engage in salah until it returns to normal. So when you see the eclipse, you immediately engage in dua. You don't make an issue of tourism out of an eclipse. People go far and wide traveling to the North Pole in order to see how it's going to look and laugh and joke and so on. No. When we look at it, when we see it, it's not haram to look at it because the hadith says, فَإِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ ذَلِكَ. When you see that, then you should make sure you are making dua. You are asking for forgiveness. You are engaged in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You go into salah until the time when this thing returns to normal. This was a clarification that was made on the day of the death of Ibrahim ibn Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then subhanallah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the same ninth year, towards the end of the ninth year, the beginning of the tenth year of Hijrah, he sent a few of his companions to some of the areas that had accepted Islam in order to teach them the deen. So this was a method of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, part of his tariqah, part of his way. He would send some of the knowledgeable companions to one area in order to teach them their deen. And this is why those scholars of Islam up to this day who leave their little towns and cities in order to go and do imama or in order to go and teach people in a different city, they fall under the sunnah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from them and from us all. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent from amongst those whom he sent, I'm only going to speak of two, Mu'adh ibn Jabal and Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiyallahu anhuma. He sent them to Yemen, different parts of Yemen. Yemen was very big. They had accepted Islam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he walked with them, and as he left with them to the outskirts of Medina, he was advising them, O Mu'adh, إِنَّكَ تَأْتِي قَوْمًا أَهْلَ كِتَابٍ فَدْعُهُمْ إِلَىٰ شَهَادَةِ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. You will see people who belong to the people of the book. When you see them, call them towards worshipping Allah alone and inform them that I am the messenger. Call them towards La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَإِنْهُمْ أَطَاعُوكَ لِذَلِكَ فَأَعْلِمْهُمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ افْتَرَضَ عَلَيْهِمْ خَمْسَ صَلَوَاتٍ فِي كُلِّ يَوْمٍ وَلَيْلَةٍ. If they follow you regarding that, then you should let them know that Allah has made compulsory upon them 5 salah throughout the day and night. فَإِنْهُمْ أَطَاعُوكَ لِذَلِكَ. And if they follow you regarding that, then you should let them know that there is a fast that they have to engage in. And if they follow you with that, then let them know that there is a charity, a zakah, that they need to give out. And so on. And this is how the Prophet ﷺ taught Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Then he tells him, Ya Mu'adh, اتَّقِ دَعْوَةَ الْمَظْلُومِ فَإِنَّهُ لَيْسَ بَيْنَهَا وَبَيْنَ اللَّهِ حِجَابٍ. Be careful of the dua made by an oppressor against you. Sorry. Be careful of the dua made by the oppressed against the oppressor. For indeed, there is no barrier between that dua and Allah. If someone is oppressed, if someone is hurt and harmed, and someone is wronged, if they have to raise their hands and make dua against you, if you are the oppressor, you have had it. That's what the Prophet ﷺ is saying. Because there is no barrier between that dua and Allah. If it doesn't get to you today, it will get to you tomorrow. The lesson comes to all of us. Sometimes we wrong people, we harm them, we oppress them in a big way. The term dhulm has no proper English translation. We use the word oppression, but oppression has a meaning that includes dhulm, and dhulm includes much more than that as well. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam warns Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Then he tells both of them, Abu Musa and Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhuma. He says, يَسِّرَا وَلَا تُعَسِّرَا وَبَشِّرَا وَلَا تُنَفِّرَا. You are going to go make things easy for people, don't make them difficult. And give them good news, don't doom them. Subhanallah, don't give them bad news. بَشِّرَا وَلَا تُنَفِّرَا. Give them good news. Don't talk to them in a way that they go away from you. And this is a lesson for all of us who speak to the Muslims. And even who speak to the non-Muslims. When we speak, there needs to be a way of speaking. We will never compromise what is right and wrong, but put it across in a way that perhaps is most palatable. If you have tried your best and they still don't want to accept it, that's between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for as long as you have tried your best. Then there was a statement that came from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that made Mu'adh ibn Jabal cry. He says, ya Mu'adh, perhaps when you come to Medina next, you won't see me, subhanallah. Perhaps you will pass by my masjid and you will pass by my grave. Mu'adh ibn Jabal began to weep. Weep. This was a prophecy that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in his last year. He says, if you come next year, ba'da ami hadha, after this year of mine, You may not see me. Perhaps you will pass by my masjid and my grave. Subhanallah. Now, just to take you forward, do you know when Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu came back to Medina? When the janazah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was leaving. That was next when he saw Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this was true, it was a prophecy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness and may He open our doors. We need to move in to one of the big, one of the major events that took place in the 10th year of Hijri. And I'm going to take a little bit of time mentioning this, seeing that tomorrow will be the last of the episodes of the seerah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had received verses from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا.
It is compulsory from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it compulsory upon those who are able and capable to go for Hajj. To Makkah al-Mukarramah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made an announcement. I intend to make Hajj. When was this? In the 10th year of Hijrah. He made the announcement in Dhul-Qi'dah. I intend to go for Hajj. So many people got ready because it was farad on them and they had to go from Medina Munawwara as well as the outskirts of Medina Munawwara. And as they had left, so many people joined them on the path. It is reported that the initial figure was 100,000 men and women who were with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. 100,000. Look at how the figures have swollen over time. These are the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got ready. And all those who heard began to prepare, mashallah. They joined him on the path and on the road. And it is reported, according to some narrations of the historians, that on the 25th of Dhul-Qi'dah, after Salatul Dhuhr, he read 4 raka'at of Salatul Dhuhr in his masjid and he proceeded going towards Makkah al-Mukarramah. And he had made an intention of what we know today as Qiran. Qiran meaning he will make an Umrah and without coming out of the Ihram, he will then continue into the days of Hajj. So one Ihram, but the Umrah and the Hajj. 3 types of Hajj. One is Tamattu', which means you make Umrah, you release yourself from the Ihram and then you make Hajj. The other is you only make the Hajj, known as Ifrad. And this one is Qiran, meaning you join the two of them with one Ihram without coming out of the Ihram. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam thereafter began to declare his intention and they began the talbiyah. Labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka labbaik, innal hamda wal ni'mata laka wal mulk la sharika lak. Beautiful words. We are here at your service. We have answered your call, O Allah. We are here at your service, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is none in partnership with you, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the declaration of the Hajj. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had left until he got to the place known as the Tuwa, just outside Makkah al-Mukarramah. For your information, at Dhil Hulayfa, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam read Salatul Asr, 2 raka'at, which means he was already on the journey. And he had continued. When he got to the Tuwa, he spent the night there. And this was on the 4th of Dhul Hijjah. So it took them quite a few days to get there. He spent the night there on the 4th of Dhul Hijjah. And thereafter he got up in the morning. He had a bath, subhanallah. He entered Makkah from the north. The northern part of Makkah, which means coming down from Medina Munawwara, it was the northern part of Makkah. He entered Makkah al-Mukarramah. He had left the Tuwa after Salatul Fajr. By the time he entered Makkah, it was early morning, mid-morning. And when he got there, first thing he did, he went to the Hajar Aswad, obviously declaring his talbiyah and at the same time making the adhkar, the various words. We're not going to make mention of all the details. He went to the Rukn, the stone, and he kissed it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he started his Umrah. And what he did is, he had his right arm opened as it was when they did Umratul Qadha, and he walked with his chest out with a quick military style walk for the first 3 rounds, and then he calmed down the walking, but he still had his arm opened. He completed the 7 rounds. Every round he was kissing the stone. Thereafter he read some salah, two rak'at of salah between the maqam and the hajar. Maqam Ibrahim, today we see a little golden structure there. The footprints of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam are still there up to today. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam read salah between the maqam and the hajar. In that particular place, in the first rak'ah, he read قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. And in the second rak'ah, he read قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, according to some of the narrations. And thereafter, he proceeded to kiss the stone once again. And then he went up, he had a bit of zamzam, and he had gone to As-Safa. When he went to Mount Safa, where to start from, Safa or Marwa, he says, أَبْدَأُ بِمَا بَدَأَ اللَّهُ بِهِ. I will start from that which Allah has started with in the Quran. And he read the verse, إِنَّ الصَّفَا وَالْمَرْوَةَ مِن شَعَائِرِ اللَّهِ. I'm sure we all know these verses, that the Safa and Marwa are from the sacred signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he started at Safa, and as he got to the bottom of the valley, he ran a little bit, which means he picked up pace. And when he got to the top again, as he got up slightly, he walked normally again until he got to the top of Marwa. At the top of Safa, before he started, he had read some du'as. This verse that I had said, including La ilaha illallah wahdahu, la sharika lahu, lahul mulku wa lahul hamdu, yuhyi wa yumit, wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. Including La ilaha illallah wahdahu, sadaqa wa'dahu, wa nasara abdahu, wa a'azza jundahu, wa hazama al-ahzaba wahdahu. These are some of the du'as made on the day of Ahzab, the day of the trench. And then he stood there facing the Qibla, made a dua, he went to Marwa. He did the same thing in Marwa. He faced the Qibla, made a dua, read the same, and came down again. And as he was going between Safa and Marwa, at the bottom of the valley, he always made sure that he had picked up pace, more or less broken into a slight trot or jog, as we would say. Today, there are green lights between those two positions, depicting where it was that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam broke into a jog. The reason why there are green lights, there's no valley anymore, subhanallah. It is all flattened and everything is straight. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take us there again and again. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam completed his seven rounds, thereafter he stayed in Makkatul Mukarramah for a few days. And he remained in that particular ihram. And he spoke to his companions and he says, لو استقبلت من أمري ما استدبرت لما سقت الهدية ولجعلتها عمرة. If I knew then what I know now, I would not have brought my sacrificial animal and I would have made an umrah, which means I would have made tamattu. And this is why the scholars of fiqh, the scholars of jurisprudence, some of them say it's better to do qiran because that's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. And some of them say it's better to do tamattu because that is what he said he would have done. Subhanallah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam thereafter, after saying that, he spent a few days still in Makkah al-Mukarramah, and after some time he then proceeded to, in fact on the eighth day of Dhul-Hijjah, he proceeded to Mina. And this was a Thursday. He proceeded to Mina. This was known as Yawm al-Tarwiyah. And in Mina he read Salat al-Dhuhr, Al-Asr, Maghrib, Isha, and the Fajr of the following day. And after the sun had risen, He proceeded past Muzdalifah. The people of Quraysh who had accepted Islam thought he might stop in Muzdalifah. But Islam came with a teaching, go to Arafah immediately. And this is why they went to Arafah. They spent the day there. It was a Friday according to the narrations. And he had given a lecture. Inshallah, tomorrow we will discuss the details of this particular lecture that he had delivered on the day of Arafah. And thereafter, after he had delivered the lecture once, he repeated similar words the following day and the following day in different lectures of his, because this was known as Hajjatul Wada', the farewell pilgrimage. It was the only pilgrimage he had made. Why was it called farewell? Because this is when he actually bidded farewell to everybody, and he told them that perhaps you will not see me after this year. So at that particular time in Hajj, he had said this. Inshallah, tomorrow we will continue with this. We have left off in Arafah. Inshallah, tomorrow we will take from there. We will spend the night, inshallah, tonight in Arafah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness, and may He bring us again here tomorrow to continue from where we left off and to end of the series. Until then, inshallah, we say, wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad, subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.